In today's scenario, quality and technical education is the major concern. It is the responsibility of industry, institute, and government to take necessary initiatives for enhancing the skills and employability of budding engineers. Directorate of Technical Education plays a vital role in implementing the quality initiatives by conducting such programs. Under the vibrant leadership of Dr. Abhay Wagh, this is the first ever workshop conducted in Maharashtra by DTE and AICTE in association with TCET. Since he has taken over, he has taken many initiatives like the reformation of dynamic and interactive DTE website, which is user-friendly and having high search engine with highest number of hits. Within this short span of 1 month, DTE website has got 9 lakh hits. TechUp 2 is the best outcome report, which is also published during his tenure. In magnetic Maharashtra, DT has also put up a stall to get an exposure in public. Many such furthers have been added in this short span of his leadership, and many more are in pipeline, which will see the light of the day in near future. So without much ado, I call upon our dynamic director, Dr. Abhay Wagh, to deliver the welcome address and brief us about this workshop with its objectives. Please, sir.
Good morning, all. Honorable Vinodji Tavade, the always a motivating force and guiding force to all of us, Minister of Higher and Technical Education, Government of Maharashtra. Honorable Vaikarji on the way, he will be joining us within 5 minutes. Shri Dr. Anil Ji Shastrabuddhe Ji, who is now Chairman, AICT Delhi. Mr. G.D. Yadav, he is Vice-Chancellor of ICT. Dr. V.G. Gaikar, Vice-Chancellor of BATU. Dr. Amit Datta, who is the Regional Director of AICT. Mr. V.K. Singh Ji, Chairman of this institute. Ramchandra Ji Bhogle, he has especially come from Aurangabad today, Chairman of Applied Innovation and Technology Group. Mr. Ashok Sahane, Vice Principal, Vice President of L&T. Swagat Ji Mukherjee, he is Director of Region in Mumbai from CII. And Mr. Karan Singh, who is also a trustee of this institution. Of course, all my principal colleagues, director officials, AICT officials, university officials, and media people. Dear friends, today it is really a moment of pride for me as such, because this is the first time it is happening that all the principals of the engineering colleges, with they are not alone, they have come along with one industry with them, which is situated in that area. That as well, we have all AICT officials, we have all government officials, all joint directors of the region, and you all, dear friends. So this is really with a industry. There are participation-wise, if you ask me, yesterday night when I saw on a portal, almost 300 plus institutions have registered for this. I'm really happy. Secondly, industry side, 100 plus industries are there for today's gathering. So this is in a real sense, industry institute interaction is happening today. I'm really happy, friends. Secondly, it was my wish when I joined as a DT, I said there should be one interactive session and a brainstorming session with you all sitting here, so that a principals, every principal has some different idea. I'll just welcome Sri Ravindra Vaikar Ji, State Minister, Higher and Technical Education Department. So this is a really a good occasion today, that all the principals and industry are in a real sense having an interaction in this forum. Dear friends, when you have a look, last centuries, we used to say the country performing best in a war front, we used to say a powerful country. But after that, is a today's scenario, if I ask this question to you all, naturally the answer will come from all of you that war fronts is not the criteria now to select a country. Now, the country performing best in economic fronts, we say a country performing best or a developing country. If so, then an Indian scenario, Indian economy, there are three major sectors: agriculture sector, service sector, and third is the industrial sector. We know all that agriculture sector has been weakened because of the two reasons you all know. But that transformation has been done well by transforming the GDP out of that agriculture sector into the another sector called a service sector. And we all know today the figures of service sector has crossed 50, almost 52-53% of the GDP is alone contributed by a service sector. And rather, agriculture sector is only with 18-19%. Almost
the third sector, which is very important, it is the industrial
is alone sector contributed
that
by
sector,
a service
as on
sector
today, if you see,
and
the
rather
figures, agriculture
are still struggling with 28-29%. Now, as we say that we want to see a GDP of India to be in double digit, of course, we all have to work as a technocrat in the third sector, that is called as industrial sector. And when you say industrial sector has to be strengthened, the only reason that industrial sector can be strengthened, can be enhanced with the technology front always. And where from this technology will come? The technology will come, of course, with not with the industries alone, but we will have to well supported by all the people sitting here, that is the principals and the institutions of the state of Maharashtra. So, dear friends, it is a responsibility on our shoulder that we should strengthen the technology front. If we are really strengthening the technology front, then and then we can contribute well to a GDP contributing out of industrial sector. And then we can see a nice rosy picture of government of Maharashtra as well the government of India. For that, I always call it as that the industrial sector coming with this rosy picture, that will only happen when a component of knowledge will govern today's economy. And in other words, today it is called as KBE, what we call as knowledge-based economy. So this knowledge-based economy can lead tomorrow's world, and that we can do it right away from the state of Maharashtra. This was the whole idea of this all summit and workshop today. Dear friends, to go ahead with this, today if you have a look of employability, because when we say a demographic dividend, India is passing through a third stage of demographic dividend, wherein average age of India today is 29 years or so. China has already crossed third stage. Third stage, I mean to say, a decay in a birth rate, that means birth rate is going low and death rate is also low. So this third stage, we are in that. China has already exited this third stage. The overall age of the China today is on 40 because of that, 39-40. US, UK has already crossed that, 50s and 60s. So this all gives us a demographic dividend that whether this youth force, as on today, this young generation of India, are we putting them, are we skilling them, are we making them employable by adding skills in them? So this is the bigger idea, in a bigger framework we will have to think. And when I say a part of employability, now of course this youth force has to be employable somewhere. Where you will employ them, of course the industries is the major demand part for us. And that is what my idea was, that so let us call industry also here, let them hear what our principal's demand is and what is their ideas basically has to be shared in this forum. If you take today's figure, I have just sorted out some figures from internet today. As far as employability is concerned, there are very shocking and sorry figures, I can say that design engineer, as far as it is concerned, because AICT has carried out one survey. What I read is that the design engineers, which are of non-IT role, are chemical design engineers have only 1.64%. Civil engineers is 6.48% of employability. Electrical engineers, they have 6.50% of employability. Electronics engineers, 7.07% of employability. And mechanical engineering, 5.55% of employability. Which engineers, they are working non-IT field. I am saying about designing part. If you take a sales engineering job, then the non-IT people have 19.08% is the employability which is found. These are by the official surveys which has been quoted. And the IT role especially, wherein major role is going on then. Then IT role, the IT product software engineer is 3.67. I am saying software engineer only ID production side. Software engineering IT services, if you take a second field, there it is 17.51%. And third, that is IT ES operations. That is what it is, a major operation, hardware and networking. We have largest strength of employability, that is 37.06%. So this is all IT sector and a core sector engineers working in industry. This is all the employability report it says. So taking a close loop of this, again an SDI, if you see, India like country today is on 131 rank. I mean SDI, Human Development Index of 0.67. While China is higher than us, it is on 91. Of course, Norway is number one. But if you see all these parameters, SDI, Human Development Index, GDP, coming out of all these three sectors, and of course the employability, the big question mark comes on our shoulder, as well, all the policy makers, that can we make these engineers employable? This is the only answer. And the major responsibility we all should share, that was the whole idea of this. Then what are the issues? AICT has given some framework. I have discussed with Honorable Sahasrabuddeji. Universities has their teaching learning processes, and directorate has the role of administration. Can we sit together? This was the whole idea. And the real issues faced by new curriculum, which has been given by the AICT just now, which is a model curriculum. There are certain issues of the credits, what teacher says. There are the issues of the post, what they says. In some issues, we say it as whether this whole framework can suit for an industry institute interaction, wherein really a student has to go to industry for his implant training. So all these issues are there in your mind, I know. And that is what my idea was. Just come together, have a brainstorming session on certain agenda. An honorable minister has given me, he has taken my presentation. He said, I want an action plan taken to be in a time frame with all you all. So my friends, it is shoulder on us that an action plan, we have made it ready. We will have to go ahead with the action plan. I will not take much of the time because today all the industry friends, we want to listen to them. I'll just take 2 minutes of that. Just read the points that we have highlighted today for that critical issues and challenges. The action plan says that the first issue is prospective plan. Prospective plan, I am telling you, the first demand supply ratio is going haywire. We see a skewed ratio nowadays. Demand supply ratio is not matching. So we all have to work from a micro MSMEs and all. Proper augmentation of the industries has to be done so that a proper mapping of the industries and institutes and the employability part will take care only when we have a in-shape prospective plan, scientific prospective plan. So we are on line with that. Batu, I think Mr. Gaikarji is on the mark that he has already started working. I have written all VCs, request letter to all the VCs that as a management council member, I'll be coming to you. I'll be giving my presentation to you. But you all are members sitting here, are the members of board of studies, members of faculties. Please go ahead with this areas of the prospective plan and a curriculum, what we want to design. Really, if we want a tailor-made program for the students, then curriculum has to be changed a lot with the interest of the industries. Of course, the inputs of the industries are welcome for that. And that is what today 100 industries are there. So we will take in the afternoon session industry institute interaction, wherein we will get actual inputs from industries also today. The third issue we have taken, that faculty trainings. We have to train, first of all, faculties also. Then and then these faculty members in a core sector knowledge, they can disseminate their knowledge to the students ultimately. So we will have to send, as we have carried one scheme last time in MSBT, that every teacher is going to an industry for at least a week. So that we will have to carry the same thing in engineering colleges also. Fourth important item is the NBA. Today we have kept whole 2 sessions on that. I think morning 2 sessions on NBA. Is the dearth nowadays on a planet, I can say overall, globally also I am saying, India we have 10% institutions are only accredited.
when I took a quick review where exactly the process is lying, I came to know a shocking news that most of the institutions of Maharashtra have submitted their proposals, but it is in the window of NBA. Sastrabuddhi ji, sir, kindly note this issue. I have spoken this to Surinder Kumar, who is the NBA chairman. Actually, I have invited him today. He may join in the afternoon session if he is late. But that was my idea, that let this part also go, as to should be flagged up somewhere to the NBA issues, so that we can improve the NBA percentage. Teaching learning processes. Are we really using the Swayam, such a good portal created by HRD, free of charge? All IIT professors' videos are kept on them. Are we really using in the institutions? That is a real issue we will have to discuss today. Promoting autonomy to the institutions. This government is taking a total march of this, I can say that. Honorable Minister has said to every Vice Chancellor of the 11 universities that you will have to take it ahead, the autonomy whichever required by the institute, give NOCs immediately to them, so that a flexibility we will have in the state. Exam reforms has to be there. Talent hunt is the very important event wherein we can search of the talent, we can take them, we can patentize them, we can incubate them, and the startup can come up. These are the whole ideas, 10, 12 points. The action plan is ready with the government of Maharashtra. If we really want to go ahead and we want to see, as Honorable PM Modi ji says that, yes, $5 trillion economy has to be there of India, and Honorable Government of Maharashtra, they always says that we are targeting in 2025, 1 million trillion economy. For that, we will have to really try a lot, and this can only happen. This is my say per se, I can say that it can happen only through KBE. A knowledge-based driven economy has to be there. Then and then we can develop an industry sector, and then and then we can see Maharashtra and India growing up in a double digit of GDP. I am really thank you, my friends, that you all are here. And thanks for every industry person sitting here, because we will be discussing with you in the afternoon session. Thank you one and all.
Thank you very much, sir, for your opening remarks. Hello. I request all the delegates to be seated. We are starting panel discussion right away. Kindly be seated.
I request all delegates to be seated. Welcome back once again. We now have the panel discussion. Dr. Abhay Wagh's leadership has definitely been beneficial for the new insights and the initiatives in the technical education. During his tenure as director in MSBTE, he has implemented training for teachers, internship for students, and many more sessions for students as well as teachers for an interaction. Understanding the need of employable engineers and future requirements, there is definitely a strong need for industry, academia, government to come together at a platform to discuss and deliberate on skills, growth, and employability. Panel discussion can provide such platform to brainstorm all the upcoming issues and challenges and resolve the same. Therefore, The theme for this panel discussion has been kept as industry, academia, and government interaction. I request the dignitaries from the industry to please come up on the dais as panelists. Mr. Ramchandra Bhogle, Chairman, Applied Innovation and Technology Group. I request, sir, to please come up on the stage. Mr. Ashok Shahane, Vice President, Larsen & Toubro. Mr. V. Ramaswamy, Global Head, TCS Iron. Mr. Parminder Singh, CEO, Guru Gobind Singh Foundation. Mr. Parminder Singh, please. From academy and government, I request the dignitaries to please come on the dais. Mr. Vilas Gaikar, Vice Chancellor, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Technological University, Lonere. Can we have a huge round of applause? Mr. P. N. Jumle, Director, Board of Apprenticeship Training, Western Region. Dr. L. M. Vaghmare, Director, Sri Guru Gobind Singh Institute of Engineering and Technology, Nanded. And Dr. Abhay Wagh, Director, Technical Education, Maharashtra State. I request the participants to please have a round of applause for all the panelists. During the inaugural function, a few of our guests have already been presented with mementos. I request Dr. S. P. Yavalkar, Deputy Director, DTE, to greet other dignitaries on the dais with memento. Mr. P. N. Jumle, Director, Board of Apprenticeship Training, Western Region. Mr. V. Ramaswamy, Global Head, TCS. Mr. Parminder Singh, CEO, Guru Gobind Singh Foundation. I welcome all of you again. I request all the dignitaries. The dignitaries have been provided 5 minutes to share their insights, followed by 10 minutes question and answer sessions. I now request Dr. Abhay Wagh to take over the panel discussion.
Good afternoon, friends. I think when organizer asked me, will you moderate this session, I said, no, sorry, I cannot moderate because my left from when I sat, the right front is totally a vibrant personalities of their field, their manufacturing field, the software field. One is the person CEO, who's in both the roles. The such a eminent personalities are there. And then the left hand vice chancellor, both, you will be happy to meet him today and the ideas, because whatever the AICT has given us the task that the institute has to send your students somewhere for internships.
That is a really a bigger framework we will have to think all these issues. So Mr. Jumle will help us in this case. Gaikarji is there, he is a well-known person to you all. He is the Vice Chancellor of BATU. And of course, one of the principal representative I have chosen, especially from a rural sector like Nanded, like a aided college, Guru Gobind Singh College, he is the principal. So I think the choosing panel was also a little difficult for us because everybody sitting here can be a panelist. I know that. But myself and Yavalkarji thought more on this. We said we'll pick up the persons who are really and who were really interactive with the academia. Otherwise, what happens that industry people, as Kulkarni ji said rightly, we have to with them, we have to go, we have to call them, that's fine. But there are some people sitting here on the dais, rather they call us. They say us, Wagh sahab kya ho raha hai, kuch ho raha hai ki nahi. Swami ji, har dam ek 15 din baad call hota hai. Whenever he is there in town, are you there, can we talk? Ram Bhogle ji, whole Aurangabad region, he is such a person that always with a smaller polytechnic also, if I say, Ramji, I want you to be there as a chief guest, he said, I am always open to go. Such a personalities, which are, really welcome on this panel. They are the people, rather they are behind us. They are saying that you call us, we will come wherever you want. And this panel, when I called them, they said, sir, I will leave my all, whatever the jobs, whatever the pre-assignments I had, we'll cancel that, but I'll come. So these are the persons sitting on the dais. I'll not talk much on these personalities because these are all well known to you. Rather, I will give some framework to them to talk. Because what happens, industry-institute interaction is a very wider issue. And everybody is doing something in industry-institute interaction in their pockets, I know. But when I said this in the morning, I got a criticism from last 8 days from so many principals. Even my joint directors were hesitant because the letter I wrote was, sir, let the industrialist hear this. The letter I wrote that all the principals has to come to this meeting, but not alone. They have to come with at least one industry with them. When they heard this, half of the persons were little hesitating how to attend this meeting. So I was getting calls from my joint director, sir, ye banda aisa bol raha hai, ye banda waisa bol raha hai, hum log aaye ki nahi, kya kare? Main bola, yaar, around ki city mein ek banda nahi mil sakta inko. Aap jaiye, koshish kariye. But still, start is start, I always say. That is what today we have started and we have taken this initiative. The whole idea is that everybody in your institution must be doing some industry interaction. But today, I have a framework to discuss especially mainly two issues, which are vibrant and which you need rather as a principal. Number one, the curricula part. Everybody discussed in the morning session, right from Honorable Minister also, he said that curricula has to be changed, what way it has to be changed, which inputs has to be taken, which inputs has to be registered every year, is there any change required every year, does AICT and university framework allows it. So we have VC also, he will also speak in that. And second part of the framework, industry institute interaction as far as internships of the students is concerned. This is also a vibrant issue nowadays as AICT has made it compulsory. No doubt, third issue is the faculty training. Faculty trainings has to be there in the industries, which framework it has to take place, how, which are the models that we should work out as far as faculty has to go in their teaching learning processes, how they will get the time, what are the leaves, how the leaves can be sanctioned. There are different methodologies we can discuss. When I say internship of the students, so many issues are there. Because putting 1.5 lakh students in industry for an internship, it's really a huge job. The other day when I spoke to Jumle ji, he said, how many slots you have in the establishment created in Maharashtra? He said, sir, for Maharashtra, there are 44,000 slots only. Am I correct, sir? Around. So only 44,000 slots are there for internship. Of course, those internships of 6 months and 1 year, no doubt. But I am saying that there are certain constraints with every authority because they are bound with some laws and acts. But still, we should come on a single point agenda that yes, students and faculty has to be exposed with the industry. This is my opening remark. I think let everybody contribute from their area. They will see what is the perception of them. First of all, I want rather this issue, we should start with the Vice Chancellor of BATU, I suppose, because he is the right person. He is in the framework of designing today a prospective plan of Maharashtra State also. He is developing his own curricula also for the affiliating institutions to BATU. I think as a technological university, we should call Honorable Gaikarji. Please come, sir.
So the dignitaries and the dais and the audience. So you made me the opening batsman. Whenever we talk about the industry-institute interaction, I think most of us talk only in terms of the student's internship and the jobs. I think time has come that we can now go much beyond than that. Let us take one point anyway, the student internship. And I understand, okay, the point of a large number of students which are to be placed in the different industries. The problem is the industry would rather consider that the students which are sent without faculty supervision, that becomes a load on the university, on the industry. And that's where sometimes there's reluctance. And then we have the language which is talked by the industries and the language which is talked by the academia are different. The faculty will talk only in terms of research publication, the participation certificates. But the industry will have a different language in terms of deliverables, timelines, the project completions, and of course the rate of return. If you really want to improve the industry into institute interaction, we need to understand each other's languages. The second point comes, the students who go to the industry should look at them also as a resource person. Because they might come up with certain ideas which could be very different than what the well-established norms of the industries can suggest. Third part will become the industrial training. I would not like the, let us not call it a training, but an exposure to the teachers to industrial practices. Most important thing is the time management, understanding what the finances are required, and how to utilize your resources to the best of the manner. I rather consider that the industry interaction should be taken up on the equal footing, more as partners with each other. And if projects, rather we call a problems with the industry would like to solve and give them to these younger people as a challenge, and you will find probably a very different picture that our young students should can take up. And I'm telling you this from my own experience. I have been doing the exercise for several years by taking the live problems from the industry, giving them to these groups of students, and they come up with different solutions all the time. And most of these, of course, my major interaction has been with the chemical industry, and I found majority of the industries who come forward, work with us, have gone back satisfied, getting sometimes multiple solutions along with them. So please let us discuss this now on a very different background rather than simply asking for the internships from the industry for our students, because these are the two different. There's one more thing also, the people need to understand that when we send the students to the industry, the faculty participation is an important part. Invariably my observation is the principal writes a letter to the industry saying that I want to send so and so to your industry for training. and then it is left to the industry what to do with him. We have to build certain mechanisms even at the college level, how to grade or even how to get involved. The teacher should get involved into the training of the students, because this will also provide good opportunities for interaction, a very, very healthy interaction, understanding each other's strengths and probably even the limitations in the process. So now the ball probably is with the industry as well to work with us on an equal partnership basis. Thank you.
Wow. Sir, really what you said, the mechanism at the institutional level is more important. The industry part, of course, we'll hear from industries only, but institutions should be ready as far as mechanism is concerned. Thank you, Vaikarji. Now I'll invite Sri Shahane Ji, Vice President, L&T.
Good evening. Wagh Sahab, before coming to the points that you have indicated in the framework, I would only like to make a few points as clarification and then come to that, because it is relevant to that. See, we are talking of employability of our new generation, freshers. In particular, we are talking of engineering students. In Larsen & Toubro, we have the highest number of freshers that we still take as our main intake. And it's very little that come lateral. We take engineers for construction, we take engineers for manufacturing, we take engineers for software businesses. So for different fields, it's all the freshers that we have been taking. Fact is, all of us know, I don't think I need to speak it once again. Yes, they are not job ready. First of all, I would say they are not industry ready. And then it comes to job readiness. We have two levels as we identify. Once they join Larsen & Toubro, making them industry ready and then making them job ready. And to be very frank, fortunately, since this intake is a huge intake that we have in the organization, it's in hundreds that we take. We have set up our own training mechanism. All the students, when they join us, they go through some structured training program. The reason I'm saying this is, after they go through this structured training program, from our point of view, they are fairly job ready and immediately go to various sites. Now, what do we do if I indicate to you? I'm sure you will understand as to what is it really speaking required, at least by an organization like Larsen & Toubro. Typically, when these youngsters join, we have found there are four types of gaps which are there. One is, as Bogle Saab made a mention in the morning, it's the technology lag which is there between industry and academia. I don't need to spell it out again. That AICT and various other people are taking care. Till then, we may have to take care. The second important thing is the soft skills. Extremely important. A lot of awareness has already been created, and in quite a few institutes, I'm sure there are courses which are being run on soft skills, but more of it is required. The third one is the hands-on. They have knowledge, but not the applied knowledge. And again, one of the participants specifically made a mention that when projects are given to these youngsters, if it is sincerely, seriously attempted, it's 100% that the employability of that person will improve, because his hands-on skills would have improved. Unfortunately, if that doesn't happen, well, that suffers. And when these youngsters join us, we found that they are not adequate on that. And the last one is exposure to an industry. When they walk into an industry, they should be in a position to talk industry language. When they go to the shop floor, when someone says that they look into this value engineering project which is being done by them, and try, so he starts wondering what is value engineering. Or if he is told that single minute exchange of die, SMED, look into as to what next can be done, what is SMD, he starts wondering. Now there are, it's basically an industrial language which he needs to get acquainted with. So we have identified four areas in which we really give them. But what does happen? Can they directly go on the job and start working and learning? Even in L&T, no, we don't allow that to happen. We have created a training center. In this training center, we have all sorts of laboratories which are there. We have fabrication shop, we have machine shop, we have heat treatment shop, we have automation shop, we have 3D printing shop, we have manufacturing excellence shops. And all are designed as industry designs. For example, the machine shop, lathes and milling machines or whatever you would be having in your colleges. I can confirm to you, we also have a machine shop, but it is far different. And while someone is working on it, towards end, he understand, my goodness, the productivity while doing work on this job was low. And my the cost for making this whole job could have been little lower had I done so and so. Now, in engineering colleges, it's the same workshop that you have. He's the same job he does, but the element of productivity, profits, and others, which can be easily embedded, which can be easily factored into your labs, is not factored in. Now, I personally feel that all of, for example, why 5 years cannot be taught to them in institutes, in your workshops? It's nothing great. Why PEEP cannot be taught to them? Why quality circle meetings cannot be held simulated in colleges? My personal belief is, yes, you are looking at companies, industries, to give them exposure. Yes, that will be given. But before that, whatever can be created within your institute with the help of industries, let's attempt on that, and maybe they will start living for 4 years with that kind of a industrial ambience. If you have all your workshops on 5 years, and if these youngsters for 5 years have been going to workshops, I'm 101% sure after 4th year, when they go for apprenticeship, internship, they won't have to be taught 5 years, which is the basic fundamentals. Manufacturing excellence, they will not have to be taught. So somewhere my personal feeling is there is a lot that we can share with you, and you may be in a position to create it at your institute itself. Please look into what can be created there, rather than depending on that also on the industries. Because coming to the second point, it is, I also fully agree that it's extremely important that apprenticeship gives you the best of exposure, and that's what we people have really gone through. But when it comes to an industry, look at it. For example, let me speak from L&T's point of view. Tomorrow it is, again, if WhatsApp says, we won't be in a position to say no to him. But if he says 500 students have to be given 1 month apprenticeship, Jumle sahab ke taraf se summons aa jata hai, we will look at it as a burden. Let me be very frank. See, couple of days these youngsters will come in this big organization where this youngster will go and hide himself, and where they will make small groups, and what they will start doing, there are huge elements which are involved. At least in a big organization, we find it extremely difficult controlling these kind of things. If we do not give, we don't have a structured department to give them apprenticeship. It is supposed to be on job. So if you personally ask me, I am sharing as a thought right here for all of us to consider, that the first thought is, my goodness, 1 month apprenticeship is a painful thing. It doesn't give us any benefit. Industries don't benefit from it at all. If you have a 6 months apprenticeship, 1 year apprenticeship, which Jumle sahab extends after engineering, okay, 1 month will be required for that guy to become acquainted. Then 1 month he will be at low productivity. Then another 1 month little bit. So some projects which are secret projects which otherwise we are unable to take over, can at least be handed over to them. But for a 1 month trainee, it's very difficult as to what is benefit we look into. Now, in industry, let's accept some facts. Like passionate people speaking here, and he made a mention, we have two types of people who are passionate, second ones are, even in industry we have same situation. There are people who really want to do something for this new generation. There are some people who are interested in their own survival. Obviously, in industries, unlike in institutions, survival is it's a global competition. If we are not at our best, and if we start wasting our time, well, we will be thrown out of our business. We can't afford that. So people may not really speaking be in a position to do justice to that. There will be a possibility that they may consider it as a burden. And therefore, we will have to really think of as to how do we do it. My suggestion at this stage, if it is 1 month internship that we are looking at with industries, try and break down what is must within industry. try and find out what is it that can be done by industries outside the industry. For example, webinars. Why is it not possible? Let the speakers be there. Today, even in our organization, training is being done on webinars. We create wonderful webinars. So industry experts will come on webinars. There will be so many people on the country. People say, unless until you use Mac, the digital world, the tools of digital world, you will never be in a position to succeed. Let's look into as to how do we bring it in here. So we may have to use some of these things. On mobile, why is it that industry people are not in a position to communicate continuously and create some kind of awareness is created, and there is some test which is also taken on mobile itself. So look into possibilities, thereby reducing number of days to be spent actually in industries. For example, if they go and in a conference hall, if the whole lecture is going to be given on Six Sigma value engineering, that might as well be done on webinars. So my personal request would be, let's form a small body who really looks into this. Jumle Saab obviously will give, there will be industry participation which will be there, I have no doubts. All the industries who are here, sitting here, are very keen on supporting you. But let's come out, see, we are not the only ones, Bogle Saab, me or TCS, we are not the only 5-10 of us who really have to take a decision. It is on the entire, all the industries in this state will have to really respond to that. We have to keep in mind as to what will really happen, what would go on in their mind. Will they support it? Will they not support it? How it can be done to get a better support from them? So let's form a small body. Let's bring in these factors so that we are in a position to make the most successful model out of this. That's my one request. As regards syllabus, Wagh Saab, I only would like to share with you. There is a beautiful model which skill councils rolled out recently. Under NSDC, there are skill councils which are made. There is a capital goods skills council which is there. I am closely connected with that. They created NOS, you might be aware, under the framework NSQF, the whole thing has been done. Under that, these contents, it's not the syllabus, but it is the NOS which got finalized, and industry involvement was required. They made a beautiful model of it. They took 10, identified 10 participating giant industries, big industries, 50 medium-sized industries and 100 small industries, so that all the sectors have got represented. Okay, from all this, they made a council committee who came rightly on those kind of topics. They created a broad draft of syllabus. It got weighted by all these 20, 50 and 100 members. I think that's possible. And industry is supported wholeheartedly. It has been created beautifully. I don't think with the kind of contacts Dr. Abhay Wagh has, or anyone else for that matter has, you will have any difficulty in getting support from industries. So industries inputs are definitely required. We can put in our best of the experts. The latest of the inputs can come in. And like in other board of studies, for example, in the other your government polytechnic, we are on the board of studies. Industries will be more than happy. The last one, which is not within framework, but I would like to just make a mention to you. Retired employees, Kulkarni Saab sitting here, are passionate. They want to do, and such people also are there in industries. How are we tapping them? There are hundreds and thousands and lakhs of people who are at their sitting at home, not doing anything. But they have some status and would not go down to a level and therefore must be sitting at home. As mentioned by someone, would you not like to take troubles of walking down to them, inviting them, giving them that they don't require honorarium, they need respect. Please give them that respect. If you really recognize them, but accept them, they will create a mini industry in your own institute. I have no doubts about it. So please make use of it. And the biggest, of course, umpteen number of times shared by him, I myself am an alumni of one of the engineering colleges. I know what is it I desire to do, but that college is far away and no one is approaching me. I have done nothing. Therefore, I am doing something elsewhere. But alumni need to be tapped. And again, I am saying social networking, if we do not really put in a place, we do not make use of it, the revolutions will not happen. If we want to really create a wave, a revolution, let's make use of social media and let's drive these two initiatives. Wonders can happen. Thank you so much.
Hello. It was really a wonderful insight that Sahaniji has given us. See, he started from the student perspective that well. I mean, really, we have these four gaps, and those gaps can be filled in at the institution level itself. If we are trying to produce industry-ready graduate, then it will be little easy for them. There are two issues also he shared, industry ready. As well, he said that whether it is a job ready. I mean, there are two different aspects he shared with us. Especially when I speak in person with all the industry, I mean, officials, you can say, they always say me, sir, you try to convince AICT that you should have minimum 6 months of internship, maximum 1 year. So in this perspective, I will now ask Jumle ji, sir, is it possible to give 6 months? Can you create more slots for this? If autonomous institutions in the state of Maharashtra, at least they can create a sandwich program wherein 6 months can be kept for that. That can be also one of the solutions, because as we have almost like we can say 30 institutions which are autonomous in the state, 10% institutions if we say, coming out of every institution 1,000 students if we are saying, so can we accommodate these students at least for that purpose? That can be again a question with us. So I'll ask Jumle ji to comment on that, especially when he will have us. Yes, Mr. P. N. Jumle, Director, Boat.
Good evening, all of you. Revered my colleague panelists and the industry representatives as well as academicians, officials in this gathering. First of all, in general, I would like to thank the organizers for giving Board of Apprenticeship Training a representation here to speak on the related issues, and in particular, Dr. Abhay Wagh and his team for choosing me as one of the panelists on behalf of my organization. We have just had insights of two panelists, one from academic side, Dr. V.G. Gaikwad sir, and another one from industry side, the stalwart Shahani sahab. Now, after these two insights, what is now which I should talk upon is the first of all, to tell you the genesis of what is training exactly, very quickly. So this apprenticeship training has been in place since long. I used to say that it is as much old as I am. So it started somewhere in 1973, and it is a time-tested scheme. It has seen many ups and downs, and talking about our engineering graduates and diploma holders, it is doing miracles. Only those who couldn't taste the fruits of apprenticeship training can't realize it. But those who have tested among you all, there may be many who have been through this training and have seen what really the engineering field is, what really the practical field is. Because it is well known that in four walls of classrooms or institutions, we cannot learn beyond a certain limit, and there has to be a practical approach for or augmentation for these theoretical things, or even whatever practicals we do there in the institutes. So having said that, Then came the sandwich pattern training. Sandwich pattern training has been in place at many institutes. I may quote only two examples, one for diploma that is in SBM Polytechnic, Bhagwai Mofatlal Polytechnic, and another one is with the College of Engineering, Pune. So at both places, I have been witnessing it over last 13, 14 years that they have been doing very perfectly. At some places, the courses were there, but they were converted into a regular diploma. That should also be mentioned here. The thing was like, the parents and the students are not of the opinion that they should have a 4 years diploma, okay, or 4.5 years engineering degree. Means they want to get those training embedded in the that diploma program itself for 3 years. So what I mean to say now for with this example is that how much we are curious as a part of academia maybe, or as a part of academia industry interaction, that we have been neglecting this training since long. Now it has come by way of a diktat that we should enter into it. Now till this time there were many good institutes who have been doing it. I can quote number of examples. Why? Because we are implementing the apprenticeship training for graduate engineers, freshers and diploma pass outs in 5 states of western region: Maharashtra, Gujarat, Goa, Chhattisgarh and Madhya Pradesh, and UTs of Daman Diu and Dadra Nagar Haveli. So we are experiencing various cultures in all these 5 states, various policies, various inclinations of the policy makers that how this training should be. And now I am very happy that the right thing has happened, that we have been given the responsibility by AICT to see that how this internship can be done by way of on the job training. Now when we talk about apprenticeship training as a very simple thing, it is a very structured one. It is for 1 year. If it is not the sandwich training, if it is sandwich training, it is for 6 months, or it may be for 1 year staggered into different semesters. So these are very structured trainings. They can be started on any day of the year. The degree holders or the diploma holders should have the certificates with them, certificates of passing the degree or diploma, and company can call them against the slots which we have given to them or allocated to them as an apprenticeship advisor. So myself and my colleagues are apprenticeship advisor which fix the slots. Now this entire thing is done under the ambit of the Apprentices Act, which has been modified over the years, making industry friendly, making student friendly, and so on and so forth. Recently the amendment was done in 2014, wherein it was made more pro industry, so that they may feel very convenient to implement it. Now having said that, how many slots we have with us, Dr. Wagh has given in the beginning itself that around 40 or 44,000. That is a fluctuating figure, means it is a dynamic figure. Every day we can add more slots, we can reduce also if depending on the requirement. Now answering the very last question which I have raised, that whether 30 autonomous institutes are if they go for sandwich pattern training, sir, you quoted 1,000 as an intake, but it will be only the first year intake. That is maybe as capped by the AICT, it may be around 360 average we can take. So 360 into 30, around 10,000 slots are there. Yes, I say right now, right here, 10,000 slots can be made available. It is very much possible. That is first thing. Now second thing is that what will be the duration of training? Because all this, if we take it for 6 months as a sandwich training, for remaining internship training, what is the duration and what will be the modality? See, we should not think about only giving training. We should think about moderating the training, monitoring the training, and the end outcome of that training. Outcome of that training means how a student get benefited at the end of training, what he shall be able to do, and how it will help to gain a employment at the end of his degree or diploma. So that should also be looked into, not just merely pushing the for training. We should find out the ways and means that how the training should be benefiting the aspirant or the pass outs, the students. Now I have talked about the genesis, the legacy that some have been doing, and let me also quote some examples without giving specific names. Though in some institutes the sandwich pattern training was is not in existence or has not been in existence, still they develop very good relations or very good license with industry. For what purpose? For purpose of this exchange of expertise. They kept calling the speakers from industry, they kept going in the industry, they pushed their students to go for summer training, they asked them to do their projects in industry, okay, so and so forth. So there has been a legacy that some institutes have been doing their on their own before AICT is saying that there should be an internship, compulsory internship training. And I would again appreciate the body MSBT, where Dr. Wagh was earlier director before taking over as DTE, and I have been active over there for few years, past few years. MSBT was the first, is the first organization or is the first body in India which has made it compulsory for their diploma in I scheme. And we had number of discussions, brainstorming while doing that. And I will appreciate one thing, that while doing it, the people at MSBT have realized that all these boys, there are around, I think, sir, 90,000 intake is there every year. All these boys and girls cannot be pushed in merely industries only. So what they are doing, they are having the institutes at taluka levels, a small village levels also, outskirts of the cities. So where this will be placed? This will be placed in the local departments of government either, or in some local industry, may it be cottage industry. But the student should go there and should learn the basics of the business. If even the very big technology is not there, CNC machine is not, no problem. He should be able to assess how an entrepreneur is behaving the whole day, so that he can also get some inputs from his behavior. So that is training, isn't it? So once the engineer is stepping out of a campus, he is not only an engineer, he should be a manager, he should be an entrepreneur, and he should be a master of all trades. So that way they have developed the internship modality. So I mean to say that all the institutes who are present here and the officials also, they should not think that they should send the candidates only in industry. As Shahane Saab has said, webinars can be used where a single facilitator can train thousands of students in sitting all over Maharashtra institutes. Then second is a mini company can be set up in the campus itself, where some models are there or some experts are always visiting and they are training the students. Then third one, I have told about MSBT, government departments should be tapped, the potential should be tapped over there. Even erstwhile offices of MSEB, suppose a transformer is to be studied, a boy can go there and can have the look at transformers, can get the inputs over 4 or 5 days and prepare a project report. So that is a tactical way of doing all these things, a easiest way which I am suggesting. Now the very important thing is that if internship training is not covered under ambit of certain act or some law or some provisions, then we will not be able to implement it in a very structured manner. What I mean to say that if your students are going into the campus of or in the premises of some industries or maybe some setup or maybe some enterprise, even you take a small enterprise or even a shop, then what should be the, I mean, the set of behavior of that student over there, how it can be supervised by your supervisor, that is faculty members, whether there should be an external supervisor from the industry side or there, or if there is requirement of a third party supervisor, not from the industry and not from the institute, a third person can come over there and can supervise the training, so and so forth. So these modalities are to be fixed. Why apprenticeship training has been successful all over the years? Because, you know, there are some set of rules, Apprentices Act, coupled with the Apprenticeship Rules 1992, which says every do's and don'ts. Okay, so when these things are in place, I think it will be a grand success and we will be able to do it in a more convenient way and achieve a good success over there. So summing it up in a way, we should always think about how we can make available the internship training to our students in the easiest way. Similarly, at the same time, how the our students should be happy with that training. They should understand that something has been given to them, an opportunity which they should explore a lot. So who will do that? It will be only be done under the guidance of a faculty member. And third, how the student can be evaluated for that one, and how we can give some grades or at least a certificate which will mention that what skills he has acquired during this particular period of training. The period of training may be anything. Now, to accommodate all these 4.5 lakh students, and even for us across the western region, 5 states, you know, we will have to talk to the industries and get their willingness also, because without willingness we cannot force them to adopt all these things. So we have goodwill developed with them, earned with them. We will do that. But if you find, or the institutes can find their own ways, that they should come up that we have identified 5 establishments where we can place at least 50 students, I think that should happen. And I will request DT for that purpose, that they should issue some guidelines that how the tapping of potential for apprenticeship, internship training can be done by the institute at local level also. This will help in one way. This will help us in solving the logistic problems. You see, if I take example of Chandrapur, there are very few industries there. So if the students want to come to Nagpur, you know, they will have to travel a lot. They will have to stay there for some time, at least for a month. So all these will not be very much convenient for them also, for the parents and for the institutes also. So we'll have to find a golden mean for that, and tapping of the local opportunities will be the best one, coupled with the expert talks given on webinars, or maybe the experts coming to your campuses itself. So I think I have touched many issues from tactical point of view, which is our work actually, that we are functioning in that way. So I could share this many thoughts, but of course few more things could be heard from other panelists also. So thank you very much for the patient hearing.
Hello. Thank you, Jumle ji. Training's genesis, legacy, right from that of the training, meaning actually you conveyed to us. And finally, he ended with the different solutions, as we adopted one of the solution in MSBT. That time I was criticized a lot, let me tell you very openly. But I took it on my shoulder. I said, let us do something. So I tried 1 year. I'm telling you, before making it compulsory, I didn't make it blindly. What I did, I made a computerized portal for the students and the institutions. Let some students apply for them. 36,000 students in whole 1 year, they applied on a portal. We gave them assignments in the industries as an internship. The feedback of the students was excellent. They wrote the feedback, heartfelt, really heartfelt comments were there. And that is what gave me the confidence that why should not we make it compulsory. And then in I scheme of MSBT, we took a bold step wherein all minister and chief secretary was with me. He said, "Wah, go ahead and make it compulsory. It is a need of a day." And we did it. Right now, everybody is appreciating that. And even industry perspective, you heard Shahani ji also, Jumle ji also, everybody is saying that, yes, it can be done. We have taken small pockets, PWD, MSCB, some construction is going on. Let civil students go there. Eclare power station, let electrical students go there. Let that will be intelligent. Processes has to be understood by the students. That is what I wanted. The diploma student is a class 2-tier student. He has to work as a supervisor in the industries. Let not him teach that maths 3, triple integrations and derivatives. No need of that. Let him teach, let him learn what he wants. And that is what we did in MSBT pattern. Here the scene is little different in degree side, and that's what we are taking the opinions of all these personalities. Now I'll call upon V. Ramaswamiji. He is a global head of TCS ION. ION, you must have heard this. He is working a lot with the campuses, universities, all software, end-to-end solutions. They are pioneer in that. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Abhay Wagh, and everyone on the audience and on the stage. Thanks for the opportunity to share a few thoughts on this. I'll restrict my comments to two or three things in the 5 minutes. First is framing of the problem statement itself. We talked about the industry ready, and it's we always believe from corporate what we should expect from engineering institutions should not be the guy who can directly walk in and develop something for the customers directly, because our intent is to make sure that the students who come in has a very strong foundation, and that's the responsibility of the institutions that are there. But at the same time, we don't want this foundation to be on some technology that is legacy and the industry have moved forward very significantly. So one of the problem statements is the fact that in the last 1 year, and what we expect the education institutions to move forward. And we do this every year. And few years back, I mentioned in the event that Sangam should be every day. Sangam should not be every year, because you have to appreciate the fact that the rate in which the industry practices, I'm not even referring to job practices, the industry practices, the rate at which it is moving is phenomenal. And hence it is very important that this relationship of industry academia cannot be an event, has to be on a day-to-day basis. That's one point that I want to make. Now the question is, how do we make it happen? See, like in many other industries today, technology has been a great leverage for addressing specific challenges or creating new business models and new growth itself. We in TCS believe that even in this case of industry-academia relationship, technology can play a very, very significant role. And I want to place very specific two thoughts here, right? We all know internship. What is an internship? Internship is where a student from a college or from an institute goes to industry and get to know, spend some time with the industry and get to know the practical practices, right? We call this as internship. Now, why not we flip this around and create what we call as an academic internship? Now, what if you go to an industry and say, can you give 10 people who can come to my institute, or can you give me 5 people who can come to my institute and work with the students in the institute, right? With his experience of the industry, and how will it work? Can we try flipping this model of an industry internship to an academic internship for the employees to come, or the corporate to come here? And of course, a lot of other challenges that we can address effectively. But this is one thought that I want to seed in this audience. Can we do that? We don't do it today, but can we do that, right? Now, we have to keep one thing in mind. Why will the industry do that? Why will an industry like, say, TCS send 3 of their best developers or architects to go into an institution and spend 3 months or 6 months with the students? Why will they do it? Now, this is where we have to be very clever in addressing the need of the industry itself. If you give a pitch to the industry and say, you know what, we will provide 10 of our best students' effort in return to industry, so that when these 2 people come into the institution, they can work with the students in order to create something which is not a throwaway, but which is useful for the industry itself, then you have a deal here. You really have a deal here where the industry will be interested to do that as well. So this is one thought, very quick thought that I want to present to all of you. The second one is what we do. Now, this is going back to leveraging technology. We run a program called Campus Commune. I don't know, some of you here may be aware of it. We run it as a program where the students on the cloud can be connected with the industry real time, which means I open up Campus Commune to your college. All the students who are in various stages in multiple semesters can register free, right? And what is the discussion that is going on? There is a Campus Commune community on, say, cybersecurity. There is a Campus Commune community that is discussing on IoT. There is a Campus Commune community that is discussing on advanced analytics or data mining, right? When you have this,
You have to remember, campus commune is not a student-driven community. It is an industry-moderated community. So I come into a campus commune and say, you know what, this Rolls-Royce deal that TCS did a few weeks back is a problem where real-time, how the airplanes can feed through sensors to the ground team for preventive maintenance. This is a project that we in TCS are doing with Rolls-Royce. And there is a discussion that is going on, not necessarily with the names of the customers and so on and so forth, but there is a significant learning. So the second thought that I want to share with all of you, go and leverage technology in order to make industry-academia relationship as a daily affair instead of an event-based affair. Call someone, do that. Yes, you can do all of those things, and we can go back to Professor Kulkarni's 101 ideas, but you need to make sure that two important aspects: industry's time is well spent when there is a benefit to the industry as well, and you must make sure that technology is leveraged to make these interactions on a daily basis instead of once in a week or once in a month basis. Then this can be much more powerful than what it is today. So these are quick thoughts from TCS on this topic. Thank you.
Thank you, Swamiji. I think technology leverage is another solution. See, the different solutions are coming in this forum only. What we started with, the question and the answer are coming by one by one. Sir, let me answer your question, what you asked to the audience. The same model we tried in MSBT, that is called C2C. Means we had tried in a Solapur district. The model is called as Solapur district. Solapur is a drought district wherein we have 13 polytechnics. There is no industry around. So what we did from Pune area, we tapped some persons from electronics and some software industries. We took those persons there in the campus. One institute we selected for mechanical engineering, one for electrical, one for software engineering, one for electronics, like that. And then those employees were there with them for 21 days. And then the projects, small projects, they made in their laboratories, there in the institutions only. And that is what we termed that project as company to campus model, C2C model. And that was really successful with the Solapur. And then I was confident that, because my Gadchiroli people, Gondia people, of the politics, they were asking me this question, what is the solution? Now I can tell them, adopt the Solapur model. So thanks for that insight you have given. That means the solution tried is somewhere confirmed by the industries and validated by the industry. So I'm very happy for that. Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving this insight to us. Now I'll call upon one of the engineering college principal is here. Let us ask him, what is the student per se? What are the ideas? Faculties, especially I wanted to hear the idea from the faculty itself. So as a leader of a faculty, Professor Wagmare will give us an insight.
Good evening, one and all here. First of all, I'm very much thankful to the organizers for giving me an opportunity to stand before you all. Wagh sir has given three topics, basically curriculum design, industry-institute interaction, and faculty training in the industry. In my opinion, curriculum development or curriculum revision can be in two modes. One is batch type, another is the continuous type. We generally carry out the revision of the syllabus in a batch type. First year we carry out, and then after fourth year we carry out the fourth year syllabus. But in my opinion, continuous revision of the syllabus is very much important. But it's not possible to have the continuous revision of the syllabus completely. So we can have the 10 to 20% revision of the content of the every subject. May not be all the subjects of identified subjects. And that content, that variation can be based on the inputs from the industry. If I'm teaching one subject, if I get an expert from the industry, how that syllabus can be modified. But at this moment, I cannot modify 100%, so at least 10 to 20% modification in the syllabus can be done at any moment of time. That is one way of this thing. Another is that, there are two. One is autonomous institution, another are affiliated institutions. So I feel in autonomous institute it's very much easy to have the revision of syllabus, modification the contents in the subjects, subjects contents, or addition of the new subjects. That we can call is open elective subject. Open elective subjects can be industry-based subjects. Industry-based subject in autonomous, it is very much possible. In the university-affiliated pattern, we can have the institute-level subject or institute-level elective that can be industry-sponsored subject. And if university is not allowing to have that kind of subject in the complete structure, we can take it as an open elective, and institute can give an certificate of additional learning. So we cannot take the excuse that we are from the university affiliated pattern, we cannot add or delete the subjects. So we can add the subject in a different way. Another thing that from the industry institute interaction, we are discussing on the internship. As sir rightly mentioned, that internship is always the threat to the industry. They won't allow the students for a month internship because what is the concern he has expressed it. The attempt that what we did, we have created pattern A and pattern B at the final year level. Pattern A is for those who want to carry out the project in the institute. Pattern B is for those who want to carry out the project in the industry. In spite of our location, Nandi location, at this moment, 300 plus students are carrying their final year projects in the industry, and the industries are identified by the department. Because again, there is a threat. If you permit the students to take the project in the industry blankly, so there is a threat. So companies are identified the department, and then students are permitted to take the projects. I think it's far useful than the internship, 1 month internship. Internship will give the just exposure to the industry, whereas project will give the hands-on the industry, and 6 months you'll find that you'll be industry-ready student. And we are observing that we are getting the pre-placement offer to the student before completing their projects. So this is the tangential benefit of these things. And automatically, when we carry out the evaluation of the industry project, faculty has to visit the industry at least twice. One is for mid-semester evaluation, another for the end-semester evaluation. So automatically, it becomes mandatory for the faculty to visit the industry and work with the students on the projects. So there are different ways of incorporating the concepts to enhance the industry-institute interaction. We are located at Nanded, but we are having many industry-sponsored laboratory. Automatically, when there is an industry-sponsored laboratory, involvement of that particular industry comes on a large scale. Not only that, we are having the sponsored industry-sponsored code like cybersecurity. It is with SAI Industries and TCS also. TCS is helping on a large scale to launch this course, that is cybersecurity. Similar kind of course we can call building automation in association Johnson Control. So faculty from the industries are coming to teach that subject, so naturally involvement of the industry person in the institute gets increased. With these few words, I'm once again thankful for the organizers giving me an opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vagmariji. Again, a new solution came from this academic side, that can a project be itself an internship. Why can't we do this? This is really a good solution to all of us. Now, I think, okay, you'll be the last person, okay. As a manufacturing, okay, you can summarize that way. I'll call upon now, yes, Parvinder Singh ji. Now he's in a dual role. Earlier he was from industry, he worked in, defense side also. And now he is now handling one institution in Nasik, Polytechnic as well Engineering College. But his nomenclature there is a CEO. That attracted me some way. When I went to Nasik, I met this gentleman. So he said, I am CEO of this institute. I said, very good. What is your job profile as a CEO? So that is what I want to hear from you today, sir.
A very good evening. Panelists on the dais, heads of the institutions. Now, yes, as Vagh sir has rightly told, that my role has been very different role, that earlier main batting mein tha, abhi main defense side mein hu. When I was in industry, the challenges what we were facing was the students who used to come from the institutes. I will not say all the students, but 70% of the students were not, I will say, up to mark. I will not say industry fit. They were not up to mark. I'll quote you a small example. When I was in Reliance, we used to recruit 50 to 60 students, take them to Lonawala. Badiya hotel mein tharate the. Every day, vice presidents, presidents, we had responsibility to go to Lonawala, give them lecture whole day. शाम को उनको फ्री छोड़ देते थे, तुमको खाओ पियो ऐश करो और कल सुबह वापस मिलेंगे. बट वॉट हैपन आफ्टर वन मंथ व्हेन दे केम ऑन द साइट, दे वर पुट ऑन द जॉब. किसी को उरन में भेज दिया साइट के ऊपर, किसी को ऑफिस में बिठा दिया, एंड स्लोली आफ्टर 10 days स्टूडेंट स्टार्टेड कमिंग बैक टू HR कि सर हमको धूप में नहीं, हमको कहीं ऑफिस में काम दीजिए. नाउ व्हेन अ कंपनी लाइक रिलायंस वाज इन्वेस्टेड इन द ह्यूमन रिसोर्स, हाउ दे कैन अलाउ दैट पीपल टू गो? सो दे स्टार्टेड अकोमोडेटिंग दो स्टूडेंट्स. इवन व्हेन दे वर इन द ऑफिस, दे स्टिल वर नॉट एबल टू गिव देयर बेस्ट. व्हाट वी फाउंड वाज दैट द बेसिक needs like safety, wearing a safety shoe or wearing a helmet or wearing safety helmet, it was a challenge to make those students use them. The reason was college is a very, you know, enjoying acha mahol rehta hai. Helmet kya karna hai, जूते क्या करने हैं. टुडे ऑल्सो इन द कॉलेज व्हेन आई स्टॉप एनी स्टूडेंट, आई फर्स्ट आस्किंग भी चप्पल पहन के क्यों आया, जूते पहन के क्यों नहीं आया. द रीजन इज दैट व्हेन दे गो टू द इंडस्ट्री, दिस इज द फर्स्ट थिंग द इंडस्ट्री सीज. एंड आई एम श्योर विद LNT एंड TCS, वो दाढ़ी बढ़ाया हुआ है या केस बिखरा हुआ लड़के नहीं चाहिए, हमको इंटेलेक्चुअल लड़के चाहिए, स्मार्ट लड़के चाहिए हु कैन रियली वर्क ऑन द फील्ड, एंड दे बिकम एग्जाम्पल टू द अदर पीपल हु आर वर्किंग देयर. So this was what we felt when I was in industry. I went on to DMRC projects where I was doing the underground stations and tunneling. There also the same issue was there. Yes, handling new institute and teaching in our institute. What is internship? Internship is developing the skill knowledge. Not necessary that it can be done in the industry. It can be done in the institute itself. Now for that, yes, funds is a big issue. Industry is interested in selling the equipments. They are not interested in giving free. So most of the colleges has that challenge ki paisa kahan se generate kare. Again, that is not counted in FRA because it is not part of curriculum. So your fees also comes down. So it's a challenge, you know, both the sides. So what I want to sum up is that, or what I want to put my point is that, first of all, why industry has grown in such a way? It is because of the technology, and they had a very dynamic organogram. They have been changing the organogram as per needs. Par hamara jo education system hai, iska organization chart, aaj 50 saal se ek institute ka principal hota hai, uske niche ek registrar hota hai, ek teaching staff hota hai, non-teaching staff hota hai, aur wohi pattern aaj tak hum chala rahe hain sir. सबसे पहले तो ये प्रिंसिपल डेजिग्नेशन ही हटा दीजिए. द रीजन इज व्हाट इज प्रिंसिपल डूइंग रियली? ही इज आइदर फिलिंग द फॉर्म्स, ही इज मेकिंग द कॉम्प्लायंसेस ऑफ AICTE, ही इज मेकिंग कॉम्प्लायंसेस ऑफ यूनिवर्सिटी. ही हार्डली हैज टाइम फॉर हिमसेल्फ बिकॉज पेरेंट्स भी उसको तंग करते हैं, प्लस ऊपर से जो ट्रस्ट है वो भी उसको तंग करती है कि पैसा ला भैया फीस क्यों नहीं आया. And if anything goes wrong, he is the first person to take the hit. So I suggest that remove principal and create two designations. One is director technical and one is director administration. Director technical should look after the academic part, only academic part. And director administration should look after all the TPO, industry relation, PRO. This all should be taken care by that director administration. Now, if this happens, this will really what Kulkarni sahab was saying, ki dosti badao, to wo administration wala dosti bada sakta hai, technical wala nahi bada sakta hai, aaj ka principal to 100% nahi kar sakta hai. This faculty, yes, this is one biggest challenge we all have. Good faculties, aaj ki date mein nahi milti. The reason is, technology in industry has gone ahead, students are smarter than us, and our faculty are still stuck in last decade. We are not able to cope up with the technology. Kyo industry humko entertain nahi karti hai, aur bachche humse smart ho gaye, to bachche humko bhav nahi marte, iski wajah se the faculty has become a big challenge today. So for this faculty, when we talk about student training, we talk about internship, this faculty who has been teaching for 15 years, 20 years, this faculty really has to change. Aur ye koi change nahi kare, Wagh sahab bhi nahi change karenge, kar payenge. This you have to change, your attitude has to change, then only things will change. For that, whatever support is required, that definitely AICT, DTE can help us, but we have to make our mind to change that. Last was, sir, कांच को कितना भी घसेंगे वो कांच ही रहने वाला है. आई थिंक सो बहुत जन समझ गएंगे. आई एम टॉकिंग द पास आउट स्टूडेंट्स हु आर कमिंग फ्रॉम 10th एंड 12th स्टैंडर्ड्स. द बेसिक नीड टुडे इज टू चेंज द एजुकेशन पैटर्न एट द स्कूल लेवल रेदर देन ब्रेकिंग आवर हेड एट द इंजीनियरिंग लेवल. Colleges, students' problem, at the same time, if we don't tackle the problem of education in the schooling, ye 4 saal ke baad mein hum yehi conference karte rahenge, sir. So the importance today is to change the education process right from your primary to your secondary or to your higher secondary. Hamari solution, hamara jo problem hai na, sir, 5 saal ke baad mein aur bhi aasan ho jayega. So that is really need of the hour, and I again thank Wagh sahab for giving me time to share my ideas. Yes, कहते हैं ना सरदार जी के आइडिया बड़े हथौड़े रहते हैं. तो मैंने कोशिश की है कि जो प्रॉब्लम रियली है उसको हाईलाइट करने की, एंड रियली वी नीड टू वर्क ऑन दिस. एंड ऑफकोर्स वी आर ऑलवेज देयर सर, आपने जब भी कहा है हम लोग हाजिर रहे. जो भी आपको सपोर्ट चाहिए हमारी मैनेजमेंट की तरफ से, बिकॉज आवर मैनेजमेंट आर इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट, ऑल फ्रॉम इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट. So we are able to really understand what are the students, what types of students are being produced today. Thank you very much. Thank you for hearing.
Thank you, sir, for your blunt and really outspoken comments, and which are needed for us. Really, one idea again came from his talk, that center of excellence. If we really have such a center of excellence, can some internships happen in that center of excellence? That is also one of, I think, see, 7 solutions I have jotted them already. I think my work, Honorable VC is the chairman, wherein I am the member and Jumleji is the member. We are all thinking as an internship, as a bigger perspective, because a letter from AICT came to Jumleji. And as I am also a board of member of Jumleji board, so we thought that we have made a subcommittee and we'll jot down what issues we are facing and how we can facilitate these issues to the principals to do the job of internship. So I think 7 solutions we got, sir. So I think our job is done in this 1 hour business only. Thank you. Now last and best, I can say, because see, he is the entrepreneur from this all of sitting here. And see, a person from industry, from different positions when they speak, ideas are different. But now as an entrepreneur, tumhi nirlep tava aikla asel. तर निर्लेप तवा बनवणारे पहिले राम भोगले, ही पहिली कन्सेप्ट. आणि मी इंटर्नशिप मी खरं तर इंटर्नशिप याच्या दृष्टीने जास्त महत्त्वाची समजतो, की एंटरप्रिनर आज भारताला गरज कुठली जास्त आहे माहिती? मी सकाळी इकॉनॉमीचं जे बोललो ना, खरं तर आपण कुठं कमी पडतोय तर त्या टेक्नॉलॉजी फ्रंटला आपल्याला चांगले एंटरप्रिनर्स हवे आहेत. आणि द एंटरप्रिनर्स हे नुसते असं एका दिवसात होत नाही, तो माइंडसेट जनरेट करावा लागतो आणि तो स्टुडंटशिपपासूनच झाला पाहिजे असं माझं मत आहे. आणि म्हणून मला असं वाटतं रामजी यू आर अ राईट पर्सन टू एंड दिस टॉपिक, आय थिंक तुम्हीच बोलावा आणि तुम्ही समराईजसुद्धा करावा आता माझ्या वतीने.
Thank you, Dr. Wagh. See, basically, I'll also restrict my speech to three major points that Mr. Wagh raised in his initial address. One is curriculum framing, and wonderful ideas were shared by many people, but I would support Dr. Wagmare's idea of that flexibility, about 10% to 20% curriculum to be changed every year. It's a continuous process. You can't do the entire thing in 10 years or 20 years. So best thing is change about 10% or 20% every year. I support that idea. But the best still would be, I mean, why do you need to change curriculum? Because the technology and the practices have changed. But I would still feel that if the institutions create that technology and practices to be followed by industry, automatically the curriculum would change as the institution develops new things, and there would not be a rigid framework in institutions, and the industry would follow institutions rather than the institutions following industry. So we need to actually change this emphasis. I would also support this idea of flipping. It was a great idea. Instead of students going to industry, why can't the industry come to institutes and spend time? Because when students come to industry, unfortunately, like Mr. Singh mentioned, that in the entire school education, the focus is on the mark sheet. It's never on the knowledge of the subject. The entire focus is on the mark sheet. And throughout the education, the entire emphasis is on the paper that is given as a degree, because that opens up job market. Idea is not to learn. Idea is to earn that degree so that you can start earning for your livelihood. As long as students come with this kind of attitude to industry, industry would not welcome it, because I have realized, and we have been requested at times where students said that, oh, we have to spend 15 days in industry. So what we would do is we would come on the first day, we would come on the last day and give us a certificate. They had that audacity because for them that certificate was important, the learning was not important. And we have instilled this attitude in the students from their childhood. So I support that, yes, we need to change it from primary education. Only changing it in professional education or technical education is not going to help. But such an attitude displayed by students coming to industry actually puts off industry from coming forward for helping the institutes in providing any internship opportunities. Talk of faculties accompanying the students. You see, the industry culture is very different. I would like all my trainees and interns to be present when the shift starts. If it starts at 7 o'clock in the morning, they bloody well be there at 7 o'clock in the morning. If the faculty feels that my day starts at 10 o'clock in the morning and we will, along with students, reach industry at 10 o'clock, and because my day is 5 clock hours, I would leave the industry around 3:30 so that I can be home by 4:30. The industry is not going to like this, because we work for 8.5 hours minimum. That includes half an hour of lunch time. And for entrepreneurs, I remember when I left engineering college and joined my father's business, I used to be in plant at sharp at 7:45 in the morning, because the general shift would start at 8 o'clock. And then I would reach home sometime at
11 o'clock or 12 o'clock in the night. Whereas in engineering college, I used to spend from 10 o'clock till maybe 3, 3:30. And within that short span also, I would be absconding for 2 hours. So the actual classroom attendance used to be 40% of the time when I used to be there. Practical attendance would be 100%. Because there everybody was watching you and, well, I was interested in doing the practicals. Question is, these are two different cultures. In educational institution, you have a different culture. If the faculty has to come to industry along with the students, they are expected to follow what the industry follows, because the industry would not like someone who has come to learn to disturb their culture. So the best way would be for industry to go to institutes for as much period as possible. So splitting what can be created in institute, what can be given in institute, is to be given in institute by the industry, and then expose these students and faculty to industry for as short a period as possible is required or necessary. I think these are wonderful ideas, and then the placement of 120,000 students or 90,000 students would not make a big problem, because then you can phase it out. The industry wouldn't mind them coming to them for 7 days observing various practices. Another thing that which comes to my mind, which would change and make the boys industry ready, is boys and girls, of course. When I say boys, please take it as both the genders. Is actually in engineering college, I learned every manufacturing process as a standalone process. Whether it was turning, whether it was milling, whether it was heat treatment, whether it was carpentry or smithy. We learned them as standalone processes. Whether it was in building construction, surveying and leveling, or whether it was creating a foundation or putting a roof, everything was learned as a standalone process. In industry, nothing is standalone. It's a continuous process. From turning, it goes into milling. From milling, it goes into heat treatment. From heat treatment, it comes out and goes into some other manufacturing processes like grinding. But everything is looked at holistically, not in standalone situations. Whereas most of the faculty and students are trained to think in standalone. Industry is not standalone. Industry is a continuous process, and therefore we need to introduce this concept of looking at things holistically. If you look at a product, it has not come out of just one single process, unless it is a plastic molding. It has not come out of one single process. It has undergone many processes, and the set changes as the product requirements change. I mean, somewhere the heat treatment would come first, somewhere it would come the last. Now, unless you train your boys and girls and faculty to think in terms of all this put together and creating a package, it would not work. I was really happy to hear someone mentioned this concept of costing. Industry is techno-commercial, it is not technology, it is techno-commercial, it has to be viable. To sustain, it has to be viable. So unless you introduce this concept of cost, concept of responsibility, the students would not be industry ready or job ready. So those concepts have to be. I was one fool in mechanical engineering to take industrial economics as an elective. And I was advised by my colleagues, my fellow students, that look, you cannot score in this subject. It's all descriptive answering. See, unless you take vibrations where you only have mathematics. So you make calculations, as long as your answer is right, you get 100% marks. So you can score 80 marks in this subject. Whereas in economics, you won't be able to score more than 60. I said, I'm not interested in the final marks memo that is going to be given to me. I'm going to be in industry. So for me, industrial economics is far more important than vibrations. How many students have this concept? How many students would want to reduce their percentage
Not many. Not many would take that risk. But we need to emphasize that it is knowledge which is important. It is skills which is important. It is not your marks memo that's going to, because marks memo can open you door only once. Because a lot of industries take fancy in writing that you must have scored 70% at degree level or whatever. So only those industries are out of your ambit if you have scored 60% or if you have scored 50%. But people feel that those are the industries where we should be placed. I would rather say that don't go by that, because they are putting too much emphasis on what you have scored in your exam. They are not really looking at what you are capable of doing. Any industry which looks at what you are capable of doing is an industry where you should be going and working. And I find that many MSMEs would accept people who are far more capable than people who have scored well in their exams. So we need to focus on all these things. Unless we do that, we will not get what we really want. And last is faculty training. I would congratulate Dr. Wagh, because when he was in MSBT in Marathwada Auto Cluster, we started a program for faculty training of polytechnic. And we ran many programs where industry experts were coming. 30 teachers would come and stay for 3 days in Aurangabad, and we would take them through some theory and a lot of exposure to industry. And that definitely helped. I think a lot of faculty has to understand that training is not questioning their present knowledge. Actually, training is for making them ready for future, because the future keeps on changing. So a lot of faculty, teachers feel that, do I need to undergo a training after 20 years of having served in the engineering college? I'm a professor, I'm a head of the department. So not only do away with this post of principal, but do away with all these designations, because those designations give wrong ideas and they are so fixed. I am the head, so why do I need to? You are the head, but do you have the head is a question that I need to ask from industry. At times I feel that they don't use their head, and if they are not using their head, then the question arises whether they really have head. Now, training is absolutely essential. In industry, we are required to undergo training. I am 63, even at my age, and I am owner, I am chairman of the group. At my age, I am also exposed to training. I undergo training. No more technical training, because I am not involved in technology. But I do undergo training in various new ideas about how you manage groups, how you manage family businesses. I sit through such trainings in Indian School of Business. I have attended 4 trainings in Indian School of Business. I have attended 1 15-day long training in IIMD Lausanne in Switzerland. I don't say that I don't need training at age of 63. And I have seen faculty at age of 50 saying that we don't need to be trained. We know what to teach. You know what to teach, because what you are teaching has not changed in last 20-25 years. But the industry has changed. You need to realize that. Therefore, faculty training is equally important, and we need to bring them to this. This reality has to be actually driven home, that you need a training till the day you retire. And frankly speaking, I would want to see a day when, as long as they are physically and mentally fit, they do not retire. With this, I would like to close, because it's already very late. Thank you.
Thank you, Ramji. I'm really speechless, because really you have summarized in a nice way. Real insight of industry has given to us, right from entrepreneurship, studentship, everything. Thank you all. We have just crossed our boundaries of the time frame. But still, I think the session was very interesting. Everybody spoke from the heart. That was very important. And let me tell you only one line. How I connected with these dots, only with this what Kulkarni said. You just go to industry comes to you. Only one line. When I was in MSBT,
I connected 100 industries with MSBT, 100. No industry was connected that much with the MSBT that time. Just a phone call. When I went to my assembly session in Nagpur, I just went to an Mahindra & Mahindra company, just visited that, met the CEO, went with the bouquet, flowers bouquet, said, I am here, sir, I want to have a cup of tea with you. I said, very good, sir, aapko time mil gaya, aap aa gaye hamare paas baithiye. We had a round in the, I said, sir, I want single request to you. He said, tell me, I just want to train my faculties of Nagpur region in Mahindra & Mahindra. He said, bole, sir, kal se bhej dijiye, there is no need of MOU also. See, the only a one call or a only one visit makes the change. So I think the right suggestion was there from Jumleji that all these eminent personalities, what they said, that let us try. Let us try, we'll do it. And I think, sir, we, now as I am the head of the directorate and all these fraternities sitting in front of me, I give you the assurance on their behalf that ki next time when we'll meet, everybody of this chamber who has sat here will come with the 50 slots ready-made, he will make for his students, and then we'll come to you. That is what we commit you. This is what a commitment I have given on your behalf. Thank you. Thank you very much, Purvaji. I think you should go ahead with your next program. I think we should close up the session now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Mr. Murve, Under Secretary, Higher and Technical Education, Maharashtra State, to please come on the dais. I request Dr. Abhay Wagh to greet him with a memento.
See the persons of ministry, how they are interested. I have just requested yesterday, Under Secretary of our Higher and Technical Education, he is there to listen what is going in academics and industry. Please clap. This is the spirit. I am really happy. So I just said that, Let us greet him.
I request Mr. Murve to please take a seat here on the dais. Thank you, sir. Now I call upon Mr. Pramod Naik, Joint Director DTE, to summarize today's proceedings.
Honorable Director, Dr. Abhay Wagh, Director of Technical Education, Maharashtra State. All the dignitaries on the dais, all the invitees for this today's workshop. Good evening to all of you. We are in the last segment of the program, and I am here to summarize the day's event. Whatever happens in the class, we have to revise that what has missed, main points has to be highlighted. As you all are aware, recently we participated in the Magnetic Maharashtra Convergence 2018, which was inaugurated by the Honorable PM and with the presence of Honorable CM and the Honorable Ministers. India is transforming fast. In the size of economy and the ease of doing the business, Maharashtra is the top performer in overall competitions. Why I'm quoting this is, we are in the era of liberalization, privatization, and globalization of the Indian economy. This has impacted the working of every organization, including the educational organizations. Concern for the quality and the relevance for the programs have become the parameters of prime importance. India, having one of the largest share of youth population in the world, has a great potential to fulfill the demands of the global talents market. So we need to change fast to respond to these expectations. Maharashtra State, being one of the important educational hubs of the India, that has made a significant contribution towards the development of engineering and technology sector. But there is a long way to achieve cost-effective education, employability, quality of education, research and development. This can only be achieved by healthy interactions and the long-sustaining partnership initiatives between the industry and the institutions. Keeping this in mind, under the leadership of Dr. Abhay Wagh, Director of Technical Education DTE, took a bold and dynamic initiative in collaboration with the All India Council of Technical Education and the Thakur Engineering College, which came out with the idea of this one-day workshop on enhancing the quality of technical education issues and challenges. Today, we have in the inaugurations, objective of workshop was very well spelled by Honorable Director Dr. Wagh. The highlight of his speech are, he appreciated the efforts of the principals attending the workshop along with the industry representatives, and he termed it as a pride moment for this occasion. He also has highlighted the three sectors of employment, agriculture, service and industry. To enhance GDP contributed from the industry sector, he stressed for the close liaisoning between the industry and institute. This would lead to the quality technocrats development while transforming towards knowledge-based economy, KBE, he said. For he also traced for enhancing the employability of the pass out, he advocated for the close working between AICT, all these regulatory bodies, DTE, university and the industry as the stakeholders. Action plans is to be prepared for the submission to the honorable ministers with the following points, that the prospective plan, faculty training, NBA accreditation, teaching learning processes, promoting the autonomy to the institutions, exam reforms, talent hunts for the startups, etc. After this objective of workshop, the introductory remarks was made by Honorable Dr. Anil Sahasrabuddhe sir, who is the chairman of AICT. The highlights of his Dr. Sahasrabuddhe's speech are like, he has described the interaction between the government, industry, AICT, principals as a sangam of four rivers. He requested for two important aspects to be taken in the panel discussions, which was also highlighted by Dr. Abhay Wagh sir, how to improve the employability and how to create the entrepreneurs. Sahasrabuddhe sir also explained the AICT's initiatives like a model curriculum, MOUs for promoting internships and induction programs for both faculty as well as the students. He has appealed to the students and the staff to make the use of SWAM portal developed by AICT. He also explained about the Smart India Hackathons and the Hardware Hackathon. Dr. Bhogle sir also has given the address in the inauguration session. The highlights of his speech are, he appreciated the honest and sincere desire of the government of Maharashtra to bring changes in the education. He also advocated the radical changes in the technical education system, wherein technology has to be created in the institutions for the passing onto the industry. For this, he emphasized for the full autonomy to the institutions. Then after Honorable Minister of the State, Sri Ravindra Vaikarji, he has also made a good speech, and the highlights of his speech are, he appreciated the efforts taken by Director Dr. Abhay Wagh for bringing the industry, institutions and all regulatory authorities together on the one dais. He has also asked to develop the visionary plans which already will be taken over. He also emphasized that to undertake the curriculum revision for the better employability with the focus on research and the development. Afterwards, Honorable Minister Sri Vinodji Tawde, he has made a speech, and highlights of his speech are, in the Magnetic Maharashtra Convergence 2018, a global summit, many of the MOUs are signed with the government of Maharashtra. Many crores of rupees MOUs were signed. Honorable Minister has asked DTE as well as all the regulatories as well as you, we all, that like DTE, university, AICT, colleges to come out and design and development of such educational programs, the pass out of which will be able to cater the needs of the industries in this new areas where the MOUs has been signed. He has also asked to prepare the comprehensive education plans for the 10 years. clustering of the institutions to give better response to changing the needs of the society. He also advocated the curriculum revision, overhauling of the curriculum. He has also suggested the universities to give the, he has instructed as well as the university to give, to provide autonomy to the institutions. He also advocated the institute should reach out to the industries to promote the interaction proactively. He advised the director to form the core committee consisting the industry, institute and the university representative and to conduct the regular meetings. He requested the audience also to make his suggestions, their problems and the solutions on his official email address he provided. Thereafter, there was a session of Dr. Vial and Dr. Bandal. They have highlighted about the NBA and all, the vision of the NBA to be accrediting agency of international repute by ensuring the highest degree of credibility in assurance of quality and relevance of the professional education. The contents of both the professors elaborated on how to prepare the SAR documents based on the vision, mission, POs, COs, mapping and the attainment of the COs. They have also given a full justice to the topics which was allocated to them. Thereafter, there was, after lunch, there was a discussion about the employability. Dr. Arvind Kulkarni, Director, KLE Technology University, Hubli, he spoke on the enhancing the employability by involvement of the industry in curriculum development and in-plant training. He highlighted the following points: 101 ways of enhancing the employability by involvement of industry, meaning and assumptions behind the employability, skills to liaison with the industry, importance of the faculty in curriculum development. He has given a very, very nice speech which everyone has got a good knowledge from this speech. Thereafter, there was a panel discussions. We all are present here for the panel discussions also. And Dr. Abhay Wagh, Director of Technical Education, he has opened up the remarks and he has given the framework for the panelists. In the 3 points framework was given: curriculum part, industry institute interaction with respect to the internship training, and the students and the faculty training in the industry. All the eminent panelists, they have made their remarkable remarks on this, all these 3 points which all we witness. Friends, this is not the end, but it is the beginning. We are to go a long way to make our institutions self-sustaining while maintaining the global level competitions. Hence, there is a need for frequent interaction as suggested by Honorable Minister Sri Vinodji Tavade between the industrialist and the educationalist to come together to explore the plans, design and implement the joint action strategically to make our technical education system capable of taking global challenges. Under the visionary leadership of our state government and the able administration of the Director of Technical Education, Dr. Abhay Wagh, achieving this is not a difficult task, so let us commit and move forward. With the following words of the great scholar and the philosopher Swami Vivekananda, let me conclude: awake, arise, and stop not until the goal is reached. Thank you. Jai Hind, Jai Maharashtra.
Thank you, sir, for this positive conclusion and the detailed summary of the program. With that, we come to the end of the program. So I now request Dr. S.P. Yavalkar, Deputy Director DTE, to propose the vote of thanks.
Good evening, all of you. Our most valued invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. On behalf of Directorate of Technical Education and AICTE, let me call it a fraternity of technical education here together, convey my deep regards and thanks to Honorable Shri Vinod Tavadeji, Minister Higher and Technical Education, Maharashtra State, for gracing the inaugural ceremony as a chief guest, leaving aside his many assignments and grateful for their inspiring support. My sincere thanks also goes to Shri Ravindra Vaikarji, Honorable State Minister, Higher and Technical Education, Maharashtra State, occasion for giving this guidance and support. We are also grateful to Dr. Anil Sahasrabuddeji, Honorable Chairman, AICTE, New Delhi, for sparing their valuable time, for leaving aside his many appointments and gracing the function. We are thankful to Shri Sitaramji Kunte Saheb, Additional Chief Secretary, Higher and Technical Education, for his support, though today, due to emergency work, he could not attend the function, but his kind support and best wishes are always with us. We are also thankful to Dr. G.D. Yadav, Vice Chancellor, ICT Mumbai, and Dr. Vilas Gaikar, Vice Chancellor, Batu, Lonare, for sparing his valuable time and guidance, guiding us from time to time. We are also thankful to Mr. V.K. Singh, Trustee, Thakur Education Society, and Mr. Karan Singh Ji for their kind support to organize such a big event. We would like to thank Dr. Abhay Wagh, Director of Technical Education, for his initiative and constant support to organize this event. We are also thankful to Dr. Amit Datta, Regional Officer, WRO, AICT Mumbai, for his presence and support. I extend a very hearty vote of thanks, particularly Shri Ramchandra Bhogle Sahib, Chairman, Applied Innovation and Technology Group, Shri Ashok Shahane, Vice President, L&T, Shri Saugat Mukherjee, Director and Head, CII, Dr. Swami from Global Head, TCS, Dr. Wagmare, Dr. Jumle, Dr. Parminder Singh Ji, and all industry representatives for being with us this afternoon and sharing their views on the theme, and for guiding us at deliberative sessions with their knowledge and valuable experience. I also record my sincere thanks to the resource person, the backbone of this workshop, Dr. Vyal, Dr. Kulkarni, Dr. Vittal Bandal, for providing the information on NBA process and sharing their views through the presentations. Special thanks to Dr. Arvind Kulkarni, who came all the way from Hubli here, for guiding us and inspiring us. I also record my deep appreciation and thanks to the office bearers of AICT, WRO, BOAT, and Mantralaya, especially Sri Morve sir, who is Under Secretary from Mantralaya, for their esteemed presence and encouraging us towards the excellence. I would like to express our sincere thanks to Dr. Subhash Mahajan and Sri Pramod Naik, Joint Director, Technical Education, for providing encouragement and constant support, without which it is not possible to conduct the workshop successfully. I convey my thanks to all the Joint Directors of Technical Education, Assistant Director of Regional Offices, for their consistent efforts and follow-up. Also thanks to Director MSBT, Secretary and Deputy Secretary of MSBT, for their support and participation. I convey my thanks to all distinguished directors and principals of the engineering institutions and invited delegates of the workshop, who, leaving aside their busy schedule and spending money from their own pocket, and came here from distant places to attend this workshop. I believe in participatory approach. All officers, faculty and staff of TCET, DTE and WRO work shoulder to shoulder as a conveyor belt to make this event successful. I would be ungrateful and doing injustice if I do not mention the special support for hosting this event with the untiring efforts of the management and principal, Dr. B.K. Mishra, Thakur College of Engineering and Technology, Mumbai, and his faculty and staff members, who have worked day and night to make this workshop a grand success. I record my special thanks to Amol and Apurva in ascending to our request to work as an anchor for this state-level workshop. Finally, I would like to take opportunity to place on record our hearty thanks to the management of the TCET College and their team for the perfect logistic support and help extend it to all of us at this state level workshop. We are thankful to the press, photographers and other representatives of the electronic and print media for their presence and seek their support for coverage of the event today. We are indeed grateful to all the distinguished guests and delegates for their presence. This time, we have chosen the theme of enhancing the quality of technical education, issues and challenges, as it is a most appropriate and important issue. We need to bring a paradigm change in the technical education. I hope all the institutions shall get the accreditation and make one step ahead in achieving the quality of technical education. I take this opportunity to thank all the participants for their commitment. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, I want to state that we are all almost grateful to all the speakers on this stage. We are thankful for being with us this evening. It's been a great pleasure. Thank you very much. Jai Maharashtra.
I request all the delegates just, please rise for national anthem.
जनगणमनाधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल बंग विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्छल जलधि तरंग तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभाशिष मागे गाहे तव जय गाथा जनगण मंगलदायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
जय हाई टी इज अरेंज्ड नेक्स्ट टू मल्टीपर्पज हॉल नेक्स्ट टू ऑडिटोरियम काइंडली हैव द हाई टी एंड सर्टिफिकेट्स विल बी गिवन एट द रजिस्ट्रेशन डेस्क थैंक यू अगेन सर्व मान्यवरांचे आभार आज जागतिक मातृभाषा दिवस है सर्वांचे मराठीतून मी आभार मानते धन्यवाद